This little boy, he was 5 years old, right? And he was born into royalty. So the thing about it is, his name was Mirabel, and he was born into royalty. His granddad was king, his dad was a prince. So word got back to them that his dad and his granddad were killed in battle. So back in those times, when you're the heir of the throne, they had to kill you too because they didn't want anybody from that lineage coming to reclaim the throne. So the nurse, his nurse's caregiver at the time, got whiff of that, and what she did was she got really scared for him because she was caring for him and she thought that they would come to kill him. So what she did was she took him and began to run. They started running. So she was running for his safety. She was scared for his life. Mind you, he's 5 years old, so I pictured this thing. I pictured him with his little legs just running, and he wasn't running fast enough, so she picks him up and she begins to run with him. And then she drops him. I was like, God, where are you going with this? You know, and she drops him, and at that moment, he became paralyzed. She didn't drop him on purpose. Mind you, she dropped him because she cared for him, and she didn't want him to be killed because that's what they did at that time. So it's so funny because even in the Bible, something has to fall in order for something else to rise up.
My God.
And I thought about that thing. I said, for the fall of man, Jesus had to rise.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So when the king died, when he died, King Saul died, Mephibosheth, he fell, and David had to rise up.
My God.
And we all know the story about David, Saul, and Jonathan. Right. So just let's sit the five-year-old boy on the side for right now. And the story was David, King David, he was anointed by God. Everybody knew that. But Saul was jealous of David. Mm-hmm. So he didn't really want David to become king. He thought it would be his son, which is by right, it was, you know, he was born into royalty. But David had a hit out. So I'm sorry, Saul had a hit out on David. So David began to hide. But the thing about it is David and Jonathan, which is Saul's son, became very, very close. And it's just like God to have somebody in your corner that's always going to do the right thing, even when they shouldn't. That's the God we serve.
Yeah.
So David and Saul became very, very close. So when Saul was killed, he was also killed with his son, Jonathan. So the five-year-old boy, the nurse took him. They ran to, he ran to a place called Lodabar. And Lodabar is the place of nothing. It's called the land of nothing. That's the place where you go when you're down, when you're, it's just picture a dark, dark, dark place. That's Lodabar.
Yeah.
So that's where she brought him. So the thing about it was David is now king. So David calls and he asks, he said, is there anybody, because he made a promise to Jonathan, because Jonathan stuck by them, even when Jonathan's father wanted David dead, he made that promise that I'm going to take care of you. I got you. He knew he was going to become king. So David asked, is there anybody left from Saul's family? Anybody? So Ziba, he's a servant, he said, yeah, there's somebody left. There's Jonathan's boy, but he's crippled. Isn't it like when you are being called, when God is speaking after you, there's always somebody there to throw salt on your name. David didn't ask what condition he was in. David didn't say what's going on with him. David just asked, is there anybody from Saul's family left? And he said, yeah, Jonathan's boy. You know, Jonathan's boy, but he's crippled. So David sent for Mephibosheth. And the thing about it is, when David became king, mind you, Mephibosheth is still in hiding. So now that David is king, he's thinking that he's calling him to probably kill him. Now that they know, because he changed his name. And Mephibosheth means the son of shame. So once he went to Lodabar, he changed his name. But isn't that how we are? When we can be saved, sanctified, Holy Ghost filled, but when we fall back into sin, everything about us changes. Our old street names come back up, and everything changes about us. So he said, yeah, old Mephibosheth, he's still alive, Jonathan's son, Saul's grandbaby, but he's crippled. David said, go get him. So when Mephibosheth heard this, I can only imagine what he's feeling, what he's thinking, like, wow, they found me. Now they're going to kill me. So he comes to him, he comes to David, and the thing about it is, God will find you no matter where you are.
That's true.
See, Mephibosheth didn't go searching, he didn't go seeking. He was born into royalty, and that's what sometimes some of us forget. We're born into this thing. This is our right. He was born into it. So no matter where he went, God was going to find him. He found him in Lodabar. Whether it's Lodabar, the bar, wherever you at right now, God will find you. And he's seeking after you. So David sought after Mephibosheth. And when he came, he thought he was going to, you know, take him out because he's really the heir to the throne in their eyes in that time. So David was like, no, I came, you know, to do good. You will always eat at my table because of the promise I gave to your father. And that's the thing. There's a promise that was given to us by our father.
Come on.
And we are not understanding it. We can't get past ourselves being crippled.
Right.
And how many of you know, though, we may be crippled, God is capable. And that's the thing about it. So even Mephibosheth, when he got in front of David, he's like, you seeking after a dead dog like me? But you're royalty. And you're not understanding that. So Ziba was told by King David that he had to take care of Mephibosheth, and Mephibosheth had a son. So once I got into a deeper study, I was like, wow, he hid that whole time, like nobody found him. But the thing about it is, God will hide us until it's our time.
That's right.
Because think about this. At 5 years old, he was paralyzed. And that made him run, and it made him hide. Mm-hmm. And all along, God had a plan. God had to hide him. Because if not, he would be also fighting in the battle. His brother fought against David and died. His brother, well, he didn't fight David. They killed him in his own home. But the thing about it is that family, that lineage, they have died because they didn't want anyone to reclaim the throne. So think about if Mephibosheth never was paralyzed, never was dropped, he would probably also be dead. He would probably also be killed. So I think about this. I said the things that we go through, because some of us fall and some of us are dropped.
Right.
You know, some of us are dropped by people that mean well.
Right.
They were just not able to carry us.
Right. Mm-hmm.
The nurse, she meant well.
Right.
She's going to hide them.
Right.
We're going to run. I'm not going to let you die.
Right.
But she wasn't equipped to hold him.
My God.
So she dropped him.
Jesus.
And that's the thing. And God, everything we go through in our lives is ordained by God.
Yes,
because if he wasn't running, if he wasn't dropped, if he wasn't paralyzed, he may be dead.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Everybody else is. His whole entire family is dead. So we can't look at it when we're being hidden. We can't look at it in a negative manner. We have to think about it like, wow, why is God hiding me? And that's what I started to think about. And with him being paralyzed, it's like, The servant is worried about him being paralyzed. He's worried about him being paralyzed, but that's not what God is worried about. Mm-hmm. David didn't ask, oh, so what condition is he in?
Right.
God already knows our condition.
Come on.
He's not saying, oh, let me go get you out the load of the bar. Let me go get you from the bar. Is she drunk?
Right.
What condition is she in?
Right.
That was never asked. All he did was ask. All he asked was, is there somebody? And that's what God is asking. Is there somebody? He's not worried about you stuttering.
Yes.
He's not worried about how you look. He's not worried about what type of proclivity you have. He's just asking, is there somebody?
My God.
And sometimes our own image of how we see ourselves is holding us back.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. He felt bad because he was paralyzed. But think about it. If you weren't there, you wouldn't be here. If there wasn't a fall, there wouldn't be a rising. If there wasn't a dropping, there couldn't be a picking up.
Yes.
And that's God's plan all along, to show people grace. David showed Mephibosheth grace.
Yes.
He said, you know something? I know your granddad tried to kill me, but I made a promise with your dad because your dad show me grace. Yeah, so I'm going to show you the grace of God. Yeah. Even though Mephibosheth thought he was going to be killed, he was actually given back his rights. Mm-hmm. He was born into royalty. And we don't understand, we're born into this.
Yes.
God chose us. He came looking for us, not in our churches. He came to Lodabar when we were lying, when we were cheating, when we were stealing, when we were fighting. That's where God, he sent someone to get us there.
Yes.
And then he brought us to him in the state that we were in. He didn't say, oh, let's get somebody else because they can walk. Let's try to fix his legs up. No, David knew. Okay, he's paralyzed. And what? It doesn't matter to God. When God has a calling on your life, he will find you. He will find you. You can't run from him.
That's true.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, Jesus.
So I just want to give the scripture to 2 Samuel 9, 1 through 8. And I'm reading out of the God Words translation, and it reads, David keeps his promise to Jonathan. That's what the whole scripture is about. So David asks, is there one left in Saul's family to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake? So see, it's not about us being loved because of something we've done. There's already a promise that's been established.
Already.
So the grace is already there. God is just looking for us to give it to us. And then it says, now Saul's family had a servant whose name was Ziba. He was summoned to come to David. Are you Ziba? The king asked him. Yes, I am, he answered. David asked, is there someone left in Saul's family who I can show kindness? And Jonathan had a son who was disabled, Ziba answered. Where is he? The king asked. Ziba replied, he's at the home of Makur in Lodabar. So King David sent men to get him from the home in Lodabar. And when Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan and the grandson of Saul, came to David, he quickly bowed with his face touching the ground. Mephibosheth, David said to him. Yes, sir, he answered. Don't be afraid, David told him. I will certainly show you kindness for your father Jonathan's sake. I will give back to you all the land of your grandfather Saul, and you will always eat at my table. He said, always eat at my table. Oh. And Mephibosheth bowed down again and answered, who am I that you would look at a dead dog like me? Even when God is calling us and saying, this is what I have for you. And this is the part where I understand why God took me this way. Because that's what God is telling me. Even though I've given you a glimpse of your future, you still see yourself as the paralyzed, dead dog. And the word hits you first. And we're born into royalty. We're royalty. People can see our potential, but until we see what we have ourselves, nothing is going to happen. We will remain paralyzed.
That's right. That's right.
And that's what he was saying. That's what was going on here.
That's very good.
David said, you will always have a seat at my table.
Yes.
Always. God does not care. He made us. He knows what's going on inside of us. He does not care. He is the God of restoration.
Thank you, God.
If you have fallen, he is the one that is going to pick you up with your paralyzed self and let you do the thing.
Yes.
And that's what I had to realize even in myself. I'm like, people just depend on me too much. They expect too much out of me. Even this morning, I already knew I would be the one speaking. I knew it last night, and that's when all trouble started happening, literally. And I was like, okay, God, I'm just going to study. And the more I study, the more I'm like, okay, I can't study. He gives me key points, and I'm going to just stick to some key points and just let him do what he do.
Right.
But it's that. It's us. It's ourselves. And sometimes we can't move beyond ourselves.
Right.
And that's me being paralyzed. That's my problem. My problem is, Mellisa, you don't think that you're good enough.
Wow.
But God said, you're already born into this.
Yes.
This is your birthright.
Yes.
You already got it. But here I am, but Lord, my legs don't move. I can't move my feet. I just want to sit here in the Lodabar.
Yes.
And God had to come and send somebody to say, you know something, it's time to come out of Lodabar. The king is calling for
you. Bye-bye.
All right.
The king wants you.
Yes.
And I'm like, oh, God, you still want me? Really, is it me you really want, God? You know, sometimes I have my bad attitude, God, and sometimes people get on my nerves, and I don't want to talk to nobody, God. And God said, it is you.
Uh-huh.
I don't care about your lame feet. I don't care about you being paralyzed. I call you to my team.
My God.
And sometimes we can't get past that. It's us that God is calling to his table.
Yes.
And God came and got me out of Lodabar. The bar, Lodabar, every bar, all that. And he called me.
Yes,
and he's doing the same for you. And if it's you today that is feeling lame, that is feeling paralyzed, that is feeling like, oh, is it really me that you want, God? Yes, it is. You, no matter what you're going through with your lying self, with your cheating self, God is calling you out of Lodabar. Lodabar, it could be your mind state. Place where you just feel empty. That place where you just feel alone. What is your Lodabar?
Yes.
What is keeping you paralyzed on today when God is calling you to sit at his table forever?
My God.
He said, you will always eat at my table.
Oh.
He didn't say, come eat a meal with me. He said, always. And that's what we have to realize. God is calling us from Lodabar to sit and eat at his table always.
Yes, Lord.
So if that is you on today, and you know that you're in that Lodabar place, and you know God is calling you, and you may be a little scared, like Mephibosheth. He was scared because he thought he was being called. He thought he was being summoned to die.
That's right.
And if it's you that have been dropped or even have fallen, because like I said, some of us, we fell.
Yeah.
Nobody dropped us. It was just us, ourselves.
That's right.
We fell.
That's right.
And we feel now that we've fallen, we're not good enough to be used by God.
Right.
So we decided to stay in that Lodabar place. Why? Because that's the place of comfortability.
My God.
And then there are some of us that have been dropped. Maybe not on purpose, maybe on purpose. But your dropping was for a purpose. If he was never dropped and never paralyzed, he would have never been shown the grace of God. And that's how God works. He uses those same situations to show us his grace, to show us his love. So when Mephibosheth is like, wow, when David could have killed him, had the right to kill him, he showed him grace. And that's what we're supposed to show other people.
Come on.
Yes. Once someone shows us grace, it is our job to show grace.
Yes.
Once grace has been sown into your life, it is your job to sow grace.
That's right.
Back.
That's right.
Amen.
Who are we to say, you know something? I was a little crippled, but now I'm walking and I'm walking fine. And you crippled, you're crippled. I don't want to be with you.
Yeah.
No, baby, I was crippled. Let me show you how to get your legs straight so that you can walk the way I'm walking.
Yes.
That's what God saved us for.
Yes.
It's not for us, but it's to help somebody
else. Say it.
Yeah.
And that was Mephibosheth. That was his destiny.
Yes.
To be shown the grace of God. That was his destiny.
Mm-hmm.
So on today, if it is you that are in that Lodabar state, that it's in that Lodabar place where you just feel, you feel like you're not worth it. You feel like you're not worthy. Mm-hmm. You feel that God cannot use you. I'm going to tell you today that God does not care about your proclivities. He does not care.
That's good.
He is God.
Yes.
And he knows all about it.
Yes.
He knows all about it. He's going to use that very thing, that very testimony, to help somebody else.
Yes.
Because if I always felt worth it, if I always felt entitled, the one that's coming after me, that feels unworthy, that feels lonely, that feels rejected, I could never, ever reach her or him. But being that I was in that place, and I was paralyzed, and now I'm not because God showed me grace.
Yes.
Now I can save and I can help somebody else.
Yes.
And that's what it's all about. It's not about us.
Yes.
And that's what God kept doing with me this morning. I'm like, oh God, I know you said I'm going to be up here, but come on, God. And he was like, it's not about you.
Right.
It's not about you. It's about who needs to hear this message. It's about that person that mind is so confused and feel like they can't be used or they're nothing. It's about them.
My Lord.
So if that is you on today, I would like to pray. Actually, I would like everybody to stand up. Because we're all in a Lodabar state at one point in our mind. And sometimes lower bar wants to come back up at us.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
You know, that place wants to remind you, remember when you were here? Remember when you were here? We were pretty cool. It was cool. Nobody bothered you. You didn't have no responsibilities. You know, nobody was dependent on you. You know, let's think, let's come back to lower bar.
Mm.
Come back to lower bar.
Mm.
But God says He has a different plan for our lives.
My love.
He has a different plan for our lives.
Yes,
Father God, in the name of Jesus, oh God. As we come before the throne all this afternoon, oh God, we thank you for your grace, Father. But there is somebody on today that is feeling frustrated, oh God, that is feeling not good enough, oh God, that is in that lower bar state of mind, Father. We ask that you touch them now in the mighty name of Jesus, Father. We know that you have a plan for each and every one of us, God. Strengthen us now to believe in ourselves as you believe in us, God. Strengthen us now to believe who we are in you, oh God. In ourselves, we may be weak, Father. In ourselves, we may be paralyzed, Father. In ourselves, we may even be crippled. But you are a capable God, and you're capable of doing everything. So, Father, we lay everything to you now. We lay it at the altar. We give all of the broken pieces to you. Every shattered piece, Father, of our minds, of our hearts, oh God. And we give them to you, asking that you put them back together. Not the way that they were, but better. Because you're a God of better. You're a God of bigger, Father. And we believe you, oh God. We thank you for your grace and your mercy, Father. We ask that you renew our minds in you so that we may see ourselves how you see us, oh God. Not the kitten, Father, but the lion, oh God.
Yes.
Let the lion rise up in us, Father.
Yes, Lord.
And take its rightful place,
Father. Yes, Lord.
We thank you now, oh God, for changing our minds, for changing our hearts,
yes,
Father. In bringing us back to you,
my God,
to sit and eat at your table,
yes, Lord,
forever. We thank you now, and we count it done in Jesus' name.